Oh, here, let me, I want to put on my headphones here.
I have a joke about that, but you'll get mad.
I'm sure it's hacky as hell. Let me guess, it's like, what do we want? A cure for Tourette's. When do we want it? Cunt! That's like a classic.
No. Are we rolling? I was going to say, you were. Can we talk about this?
Sure.
Well, you know somebody who's going to Spain.
Yes. To my husband, Gardner Comfort. He's going over Memorial Day weekend.
To talk about?
He's doing a TEDx talk in Madrid. That's Madrid, to all of you ignoramuses. about having Tourette's. About,
right.
You know, being part of a community that has its own understandings.
Right. And I was just thinking, as you said that to me, it must be difficult to have Tourette's in Spain if you don't speak Spanish, because how can you blurt out
obscenities?
In,
oh, boy.
Puta? Would that help him?
But that isn't a real thing, right?
Well, it is. It's called coprolalia.
Mm-hmm. And copra what?
Coprolalia.
C-O-P-R-O.
C-O-P-R-O-L-A-L-I-A.
Hmm.
But only like 10% of people with Tourette's actually have that manifestation.
And the other 90% fake it.
No. The one that is more mysterious is the one that involves like social taboo words. Like some people with Tourette's will say the N-word or say like fat bitch or stuff like that. It, because there's like some sort of neurological Venn diagram between like socially inappropriateness and anxiety and language. And so they'll blurt out the thing that they don't want to say. It's like Tourette's is just really trippy. It's like a cosmic joke that is being played on your body by your own self all the time.
Robin Williams told me that when he was making Awakenings with Oliver Sacks, who wrote the...
Right, the man who mistook his wife for a hat.
Right.
That he got in an elevator because they were shooting at a hospital and there was a woman who had Tourette's.
Mm-hmm.
And he gets into the elevator and it stops on one floor and a big, fat black man walks in and he starts staring at her like, no, don't, don't.
Right.
And she did.
Yeah, I mean, those are like the fun theatrical kinds of tics that like people love to make jokes about and like, right. And like, I get it.
Right.
I personally don't find it hilarious because I just live with most of the time just like the actually hard stuff about Tourette's, which right. is that people treat my husband like he's mentally ill or turn around with like super intense anger anytime we go to see a movie or see a play or, you know, like we're lying in bed trying to go to sleep at night and his body is thrashing and it's like really exhausting and hard. So I have a much more...
I have to say I have a friend who has Tourette's and I didn't know it at first.
Yeah.
So there's like... And she's... The way hers manifests is like she... sniffs a lot,
yep.
like very deeply and continually. So the first time I was hanging out with a bunch of people and I just left. I just walked out because I was just like, God, this woman won't. Thank God I didn't hand her a tissue or tell her to blow her nose.
Mm-hmm.
But I just walked out and then a friend, I was talking to a friend like, God, can you believe this? And then he was like, no, she's got Tourette's.
Yeah, because a lot of times tics are like normal things. Like my husband has one where he goes, and it sounds like he's clearing his throat or coughing.
Right.
And so, like, almost every day, if he has to take the subway that day, which he totally hates because, like,
right.
people give him dirty looks and whatever, he'll come home and he'll have this little handful of lozenges in his jeans pocket and he'll put them on the nightstand or on our dresser. And it's...
Wow.
Yeah.
That's, you know, I'm sorry, I'm laughing. That is a little bit funny.
Well, no, hang on.
No, I mean, it is
funny. It like, is funny.
It's a human impulse to...
Right.
You know, try to correct the thing that's annoying you and also to help people.
Right.
Sometimes at the same time, which often that gesture is.
Plus give a little bit of a passive aggressive, like, yeah. I'd like you to stop that now.
Right.
Right, exactly.
Because I have an itchy throat last year. My allergies have made that.
Mm-hmm.
And I always find that I have to clear my throat when I'm walking behind someone on the sidewalk. Like, it never fails. The only time I have to really clear my throat is when someone's walking in front of me. And I've learned to disguise it as a sneeze or a cough. Mm-hmm. Because if you go, then they will turn around and assume that you're being like a shitty passive aggressive person.
Right.
So I can't imagine that's your life, like all day long. You're on the subway.
Yeah.
There's some dude. You clear your throat, you know, and they turn and they're like, well, what the fuck is this guy's? Would you fucking clean your throat at me, buddy?
Yeah. Yeah. Or are you coughing? Are you like sneezing on me? Because
right.
Sometimes he'll go, like he makes this explosive noise slash movement through his nose, like a breath movement. It's not even a breath. It's just like a kind of
right
short, sharp expression. I don't know how else this gets like that specific and that difficult to describe. But people think he's like snotting on them.
Mm-hmm.
You know? It's weird. It's trippy.
Well, it's great to see you guys.
It's great to see you, too.
Oh, hi.
Enough about my husband's neurological disorder. How are you?
Welcome to the show.
David, I haven't seen you since we made America Great Again.
Yes, we did. Can you get... Let me introduce... Don't touch the microphone.
You know what? I'm going to adjust the microphone during the show.
What, we got GG Allin over here?
I am going to throw shit at you guys over the course of the show.
Who's GG Allin?
Oh, he was this... really
hey, Grandpa.
Insane,
Jesus
aggressive.
Christ.
I can't believe you don't know who GG Allin
is.
I feel like he would be right up your alley in terms of think people to know about.
And it's the world's greatest music reference if you have to make a joke about punk rock, especially.
Okay.
Yeah. So he was this really self-destructive and outwardly destructive punk alleged musician who would like cut himself with broken bottles and like shit uh-huh. in his own hands and like fling it at the audience.
You mean I'm a musician?
Yeah. Apparently so.
He also...
You should have had a like little duo together.
He had a band called the Murder Junkies.
Yes.
And they were called that because they were junkies. And they shot up together.
Mm.
And so it was a very... It was like everything that you think about a hard partying, early death, rock and roll lifestyle. GG Allin lived it. He was covered in tattoos. He was a maniac.
Did he live?
No,
he's
dead.
He's dead. He died youngish.
He played right in this neighborhood.
Yeah,
like this was his stomping grounds.
Mm-hmm.
Like, you know, there was a big shooting gallery a few blocks down from here. He would
right.
hang out there, and then there were a bunch of just tiny little DIY venues all over this neighborhood,
mm-hmm.
Where he would just go up and set fire to things.
Yep.
And, you know, it was
people.
No, he would throw chairs at the audience. It was. You only went if you were really angry. And you really just wanted to be part of something that manifested your anger to society.
And right. the music, are there albums that you can listen to? And it
all over Spotify. If
yep.
you, I'll tell
seriously?
You, what, mm-hmm. I'll give you $10 if you make it all the way through one.
There's a documentary about him. What is it called? Like,
I haven't seen
like,
it.
It's called like Twisted or something like that, but that's not the word.
GG Allin?
Yeah, but it's Allin.
Ah.
G. Allin. I like spelling things.
So. Let me introduce everybody.
Mm-hmm.
Fair enough.
That was the voice of Colleen Werthmann,
Hi.
Who is back in New York, thank God.
And yay.
She was living in L.A. for a while.
Yep.
We hung out in L.A. one night.
We did.
And that is Liam McEneaney.
McEneaney.
Liam McEneaney, author of Bright Cities, Bright Lights.
Big Lights. Bright Cities.
Bright City, Big Lights.
You say it's McEneaney.
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 You keep changing it on me.
No, you just apparently don't care to remember how to pronounce my name correctly.
Well, I haven't seen you in a while. You kind of left me.
I left for
you
Los
left
Angeles.
Me.
I left you.
Oh, boy.
Dude, you were one of the last few things keeping me in New York City. Like,
mm-hmm.
there was just a point where...
All right, I lied. I wasn't pregnant. So...
Then why did I pay $600 for that abortion, David? God damn it. Fleeced again. You know, the second time, shame on me.
See, that's why she's a head writer of a show. Like when she takes it there.
I got hot bort jokes.
What is a hot bort joke?
Hot bort. Like a bort.
Oh, I thought so. That's sort of like what a head writer says. Hot board, like it goes up on the board.
Oh, no, no.
We have to get it on the show. So
I got a hot board joke.
I like it.
David, you haven't worked in a while, huh?
Let's create a new term for writing. That's a hot board joke.
Then a bort.
No. A hot board joke.
No,
yeah.
I like hot bort joke because then you're like, well, we can't do that, but it's a hot board joke.
Yeah. We could have both.
Yeah.
Why not both?
Okay. Because I feel like this is, you know how like at some point a son's just got to battle his father for supremacy?
Indeed.
That's what's going on today.
Oh, okay. Well, like, are we both the son?
No, I'm fighting David to take over.
Do you see me as a father figure?
No.
You know what? I see you as
Nor do I see you as anything else for that matter.
No, I definitely don't see you as an authority in any way whatsoever.
Oh, okay.
But I see you as like a comedy uncle. Like I would say that, like you're an older person who has a career that I, aspire to be somewhat like.
You know, so you respect me?
No, but I just you somehow.
Do you look up to me when you're blowing me and make
you
eye
somehow
contact?
Like? Sorry. Despite your.
Why are you apologizing to me?
Because it was a bad joke.
It was a bort joke.
I don't want to get into that. Then I don't want to be like the Judge Judy of this podcast.
Okay. No, put that into the Bort joke file. That was a hot Bort joke.
Yep.
Not a hot.
But it's not even a Bort. It's not even Bort level. That's just BJ joke. That's
a BJ joke. Do you look up to me? Do you make eye contact when you're blowing me?
Well, you would know that, wouldn't you? Should know that.
That would get you a
As the blowee. That's the least you could do.
No, I definitely see David as the guy who like puts his hands behind his back. Closes his eyes like he's like the fucking Shah, like in his tent in the desert, like
on my peacock throne.
So David, I haven't seen you in 7 months. Are you getting laid?
Getting your dick wet?
Are you catching any strange?
Are you hitting that nani?
Are you getting any ass?
Are you tapping any tail?
I don't understand the question.
Basically, are you having sex with women?
Are you inserting your penis into any women's vaginas?
Consensually.
Consensually. Yep. Or non-consensually.
See, that's a hot Bort joke right there.
Define female. Human? Human?
You know what? As long as she...
Does a trash can count as female?
Technically, a female cat has a vagina, so yes. No, but seriously, are you dating David? Like, are you seeing anybody?
I am not going to discuss my...
Why not? That's what we want to know.
Yeah, like...
I came here all the way from Harlem. I took the 4 train, and it went local, sir.
And I, you know what? I came here from Los Angeles to ask you about your dating life.
I feel like that's the least you could do.
That's
the bare minimum.
I want to spare you.
Have you noticed that all the big podcasts are the ones where the hosts kind of open up about their lives and, you know, like let the listener
take
in a little bit.
Take a page from that concept.
Yeah, like WTF with Marc Maron. You know, man, like, so
would it help the podcast if I was getting laid?
And this would be an actually interesting thing to know from a host.
Yeah. We will talk about your cats a little bit later in the podcast, David, but...
Yeah.
Are you least going
on
first
dates? Are you courting any ladies?
Yes.
Okay. How many?
When you
Do they know about each other?
Courting, going to divorce is in a court.
Don't give me your pun bullshit. What is this? Wait, wait, don't tell me? Fuck
I just
you.
Listened to Wait, Wait, Tell Me today. It was excellent. It was excellent.
Oh, was it?
Yeah.
Oh, all right.
Speaking of which, so how many ladies are you dating right now?
Yeah.
I'm
going to say 2 and you're playing them off each other.
No, I would say 2 and they don't know about each other. That's my guess. I would say David's probably one of those guys that like sees a woman for a few months, but he's still on Tinder looking for other women, like that kind of guy.
Wait, but that's technically only dating one person and then just Tindering.
No, because the first few months, in my opinion, are not a relationship. That's like anything goes. You can see other people. It's when you kind of agree within that 3 to 6 month period when you're like, you kind of like, oh, well, we have feelings about each other. Let's make this exclusive.
Mm-hmm.
That's when it's a relationship. But I feel like David is probably... in his mind, at least, in the zone where he can see more than one person and it's okay.
Right, but again, on the technical tip, dating one person while just swiping through Tinder, that's just dating one person.
Well, first of all,
if we're talking about results, that's one person.
I don't think David really knows how to use Tinder, so I was just using that as an example.
Obviously, he's not using Tinder.
Right. He's obviously going, like, you know, he's hanging out after a show and talking to young women who thought the show was funny and just like... hey, if you want to get together and write some jokes, I'll definitely help you out.
I don't see David as like a young gal cruiser. I feel like he's going to date people like his own age-ish or maybe slightly younger. But like he's not going to go like after 25-year-olds. His daughter is 25, and that would skeeve him out too much. Am I right, David? Mm-hmm.
But the thing is, there are a lot of women in their late 30s who think they're going to make it in comedy if they start now. They
God
have
bless.
No idea.
God bless.
God bless them. So,
and do they think...
God bless.
So David probably talks to them as like, hey, man, if you want to get together and write some jokes,
yeah,
I'd love to help you out.
Yeah, 37 is still too young for him.
Really, David? 37's too young? What's your age range?
I'm listening. This is interesting. So
No. You got to get in it. You have to answer before we
okay,
can go
I'll
on.
Answer your questions if I want to. Go ahead.
What is your age range?
I enjoy being around women who are my age.
Okay, so what is that 70? Age range?
I would say early
10 on
to
either
mid
side.
50s. Early to mid 50s.
Okay.
Because and as Bob Saget said, I can take you to the morgue and we can open up some drawers and we can put some on the marble slab for you to take a look at. That's what Saget said to me when I told him I'm attracted to women my own age. He said, are they still alive?
Mm-hmm.
Because he can't imagine.
You know what the thing
is? Is that guy really as gross as he wants everyone to think he is?
He's not gross. He's a wonderful man.
Yeah. I mean, I feel like everyone's always like, oh, his comedy's so outrageous.
Alex,
I'm like, is this?
Make a note, I want to ask David about that off air and see what he says.
What? Interesting.
Yeah.
Interesting.
I feel like there's a little bit of insincerity.
About what?
About Saget.
Oh, no. I love Bob.
Okay.
But is he as, like, is his lifestyle as grody as he wants
he's not,
everyone?
Not at all. He's a hopeless romantic.
Interesting.
Yeah. And he treats women with respect. The only way you can make those kind of jokes is if nobody has anything on you.
Interesting.
That is true. That is true. Like, once you become that guy,
mm-hmm.
people don't want it. It's not funny anymore.
You have to.
Like, once Dice Clay became that guy, it just didn't become funny anymore. So people were like, oh, well, he actually hates women.
Right.
But then what about, a Jim Norton, who, makes a lot of hay out of, like, oh, I have sex with, trans women. I am such a gross, weird pervert. But he seems like he actually is.
Well, he is, but you can't have anything on a guy like that because he'll be honest about it and he'll be the first one to cop to it.
Does that make it less funny?
Is there? There's probably something he won't tell us, right? When people say they're an open book, they're really. But let's go back to my dating life.
Okay.
I just want to finish this thought. I think you're right that David likes age appropriate women. I believe you. But I think he likes the ones that do yoga and keep in really good shape. Like, I don't think you like a mess.
A mess. To describe a human being as a mess.
I mean, David is a fairly, conscientious person who, you always have a nice shirt on. But
you notice all those guys in L.A. date yoga women who keep themselves in really good shape.
Well, are there any non-yoga women? I didn't see any.
Yeah, there are a ton of them.
I was living in an Airbnb in West Hollywood, so it was sort of a self-selecting community of sort of...
Right. It was gay men and women in really good shape who want to be around gay men.
Right.
And, I think that's David's type. It's like a,
Women who are very comfortable around gay men. Yes, that seems to be my type.
But that actually is a good sign sometimes.
Right.
Because there's a certain kind of woman who only hangs around with gay men because she's afraid of actually experiencing intimacy with heterosexual men and also feels like no one will ever no hetero man will ever understand me or I can have, it's a safety mechanism. And then there's heterosexual women who hang around gay men because they're like, can be raunchy and have fun.
Right.
Those are two different things. They're not necessarily mutually exclusive, but they are two qualitative distinctions worth acknowledging.
You know what always made me uncomfortable was like heterosexual women who call men my gay.
Oh, it's...
It's just like really weird and possessive and
gross.
I don't know why it offends me, but it offends me.
Well, you're identifying somebody by their sexuality.
You wouldn't say my black...
Well, not in front of them.
Well, but then what?
His father owned a plantation.
Oh,
that's not funny, David. We lost a lot of money.
Is that why your middle name is Beauregard?
Well, I do declare.
And that's why you're always putting your thumbs in your suspenders.
I wish I was in the land of cotton. Old times they are not forgotten.
Yuck.
If you were born,
gross,
Colleen. If you were born,
Colleen.
If I were born.
If you were born,
big if.
If you weren't a hot pork joke.
1848, you're born in Georgia. Now it's 1860.
I'm sneering as I'm hearing this.
And your father owns a plantation. And you're
now dad?
Yeah.
Is there with me?
Yeah.
This is getting too complicated.
Well, she'd be 34 at that point.
I can't do the math. Let's just say you were born into a plantation. And
white or black?
She's white.
Okay, she's white.
Well, how was I to assume that?
Yeah, okay. Don't assume her color.
And so now you've got the hoop skirt or the hoop dress or whatever they wore back then.
Mm-hmm.
And you know, mammy.
Okay, let's get to the end.
Would you rebel against dad say this is wrong, or would you go along with it?
Look, in real life, in the 20th century, my own grandfather was drafted into the Nazi army. So I don't have a lot of historical, maybe, scruples on which to stand here, okay? Who can say? Maybe, maybe not. I don't know. The person I am now is certainly not the person I would have turned out to be if I were just, like, born into the world then. Like, everyone's like, oh, never again. That could never happen again. Of course, anything could happen always again.
You know, it's interesting.
And will.
I was really curious about how ordinary Germans got into the whole Nazi thing. Because, you know, like, you understand.
Super incrementally, like, over many years.
I read a great book about it. I wish I could remember the name of
Explaining Hitler by Ron Rosenbaum.
No, it's something else. Well, maybe. But it was just about life in Germany before and during Nazi Germany. And basically, it was just like, you know, like, nobody wanted their kids to be part of the Hitler Youth. It's just summer camp was such a big part of the German lifestyle at that time. And eventually, the Nazis just took over those youth camps and made it the Hitler Youth camps. And so
my
like,
dad did Hitler Youth.
So you had...
Your dad?
Yeah. I mean, like, everyone was in it.
Well, that's it. It's like, so basically your choice was...
He said it was the funnest camp. You would, like, milk campfires and, like,
There were camps in Germany that were a lot more fun. But.
Oh, I know. I mean, I could go on and on, David. I could go on and on.
But the thing was, you had a choice. No one was forced to join Hitler Youth. It was just, like, it's either that or have no friends. You know, like, cause all your friends were going to camp, because as they always did, as their fathers did, and so on.
Yeah, he
so
was
forth.
Like, if you wanted to have, like, eat... breakfast, lunch, and dinner, and campfire, because everyone, you know, because whatever, it was wartime.
Right.
You would go and, like, be in Hitler Youth, and if, like, you get to sing all the campfire songs, and then at the end you have to say Heil Hitler, he was like, so we said Heil Hitler.
I was in Berlin, I heard an amazing story. This woman had an elderly neighbor who lived through the war, and she said, you know, all the soldiers kind of came home one night, and then the Russians invaded the next day. And so all the commanding officers were told to get their guys out of their homes and lead them against the Russians. And he said instead, he just told everybody, take off your uniforms, you know, hide them, and just take care of your family until this is over.
Mm.
She said, like, a bomb fell into their apartment, like, through the roof of their apartment building, and two guys had to come with blankets and take it to the river and you know, like, detonate it there.
Really?
Whoa!
I wonder if we should get our money back. For a bomb that didn't go off.
But maybe it was a Russian bomb.
Oh, okay. So your father was in Hitler Youth.
Yeah.
And so when the war was over, how old was he?
13.
He was 13.
Wait, really?
Mm-hmm.
How old is he now? Is he still with us?
He's 81.
Wow. Mm-hmm.
Are there any fond memories of the Hitler Youth camps? Does he have any... fond memories of Hitler or anything that was joyous?
No, he's very... He jokingly, bitterly refers to his childhood as the good old days.
My son is in Berlin now.
Is he?
Yep, learning fluent. He's already fluent in German.
Wow. Lucky what neighborhood man. Is he living in?
I don't know. He showed me a FaceTime video. It was beautiful.
Uh-huh. Oh, Berlin is incredibly beautiful.
You know what? I almost moved there... I still kind of regret not moving there about 10 years ago because it's just such an easy place to live and it's not expensive.
If you're an artist, you are fucking psyched to live in Berlin.
And then I could just go and do gigs from Berlin and use that as my home base.
He says there's a comedy scene
there's
there.
Now a big
huge comedy scene.
They
speak English. Mm-hmm. He said that there's a deal that they're offering young people because they have a demographic problem.
Right.
Everybody is
And I'm 29, so I'm listening.
Everybody's too old in Germany. They need young people. That's why they let the refugees in, because somebody's got to keep the engine going
right.
to pay for the safety net. And the deal is they will pretty much give him citizenship if he learns to speak German. So he's
You have to do that in order to actually qualify for German jobs.
Right.
You have to take this exam. Mm-hmm. There's actually a big article about it in the Times yesterday.
So it is the official language of Germany.
I don't know if it's official, but the government definitely is like, you have to be proficient in this language.
Yes. I looked into emigrating there.
Yet he says everybody there speaks English.
Yeah, because you learn it starting in like first grade.
I think English has become the lingua franca.
Well, no, German is definitely still the lingua franca.
Well, you know, I found...
People, it's polite. Mm-hmm. You know, like there's the stereotype, right. like when you go to France, that people are like, ugh, right. if they have to speak English to you. The exact opposite is true in Germany. It's considered polite if like one person, English is their first language, that you all speak English.
Hmm. When I was performing there, I performed in English. You know, like it was just... And I found it was the same thing as when I performed in the South, which is I slowed down a little bit.
Mm-hmm.
So everybody is following along at the same pace.
Yep.
And told anti-Semitic jokes. Same thing as the South.
I actually have a friend in Germany who's an older German comic. And whenever we hang out, it's all Holocaust jokes. Mm-hmm. And at first it was upsetting.
Does he make them?
He makes nothing but Holocaust jokes.
That's interesting, because I asked my son about that. And he said he can make them, but they don't do it.
Yeah, well, it's a little too...
I think it's the brotherhood of comedians, David.
It's, right.
It's also generational, like, too. Like,
yeah.
This generation is either super lefty and, like, trying really hard to be progressive and, like, accepting and whatever.
Mm-hmm.
And also there's, like, another stripe that's very resentful of having been born into all this baggage.
Right.
You know?
And the other thing is, so the older generation, like, probably around your father's age...
Right.
...never talked about the war, never talked about the Holocaust.
Exactly.
And then the generation after them were very much about being open about it. Because that was still when the wall was up.
Yeah.
And so now you have the generation that's just like, just dealing with this fucking emotional baggage that's been handed down for the last
years. My son said, they love the Jews here. And I said, give it time.
Well, it's because they don't know any.
There actually has been sort of a Jewish repopulation of at least East Berlin.
Right.
Which was a hugely Jewish city at the time. I mean, like a quarter of the residents, at least, I think, were Jewish during the Second World War. But
they have rented Jew now in Germany.
Sweet. For rent for what?
There's
like if you need a movie produced, or if you need some banking advice.
There's a service.
Boy, I bet those camps are closed now, because they knew where to find them then.
There's actually rented Jew in Germany, because a lot
of... Is this a Lenny Bruce bit?
No, it's real. In fact, I was telling my son to hire yourself out as a Jew, because they bring Jews into somebody's home for a fee, and they answer questions, because a lot of Germans don't know what a Jew is.
Right.
I consider them lucky, but they want to learn. And for a small fee, a Jew will come in.
Show off their horns.
Talk very loud. Lend money at exorbitant interest rates.
Right. And complain about bagels.
And complain about how you can't get a good bagel. And then, there's something about the Rhine water that makes it...
It's the spray in Berlin, actually.
They invite a Jew into their home, and then the Jew evicts them.
What is the river?
It's called the Spree, Spree.
So there's no Rhine? Where's the Rhine?
The Rhine is in West Germany.
Ah, and where's Elba? No, not the Elba.
Elba was the Star of the Wire.
That's where Napoleon
was. There's the Elba.
I'm talking
river
about Idris
too.
Elba, which is Alex got that.
Right, right.
Alex Brazell, your producer, got that.
Brian Kiley, the comedy writer.
Mm-hmm.
Great comedy writer, great comedian.
Head monologue writer for Conan.
And
has been with the show since the very beginning.
Before Conan, he was writing on Conan.
Yeah.
He's BC.
He's BC when it was just Late Night with Conan O'Brien.
No, before Conan O'Brien even...
Wait, why are we talking about him all of a sudden?
Because his father was in D-Day.
Okay.
And invaded Germany.
I feel like everybody says their parents were in D-Day.
Yeah.
You know, it's kind of like, oh, my grandpa liberated Auschwitz. It's like, really? Did 55,000 soldiers really liberate Auschwitz? Because there was like 20 soldiers there.
A lot of these guys are getting...
None of my family went.
A lot of these guys are getting older. And my father used to say, not only was he at D-Day, but he saw Joe Cocker sing. Dad, that's Woodstock. Everybody was at Woodstock.
Right, everyone was at Woodstock, and everybody was at D-Day.
So my great-uncle was in was at Pearl Harbor when it was bombed. And but his name's on the wall. Like, we can prove it.
Very good.
Yashimoto Hirasaki.
So Colleen didn't like that. Colleen did not like that joke.
I was trying to see if I could make a tag, and then I was just like, I got nothing.
So Brian,
it was perfectly fine.
Brian Kiley's father, D-Day, mm-hmm. and liberated parts.
I don't think it's funny the way you're making fun of stutterers right now. Just say day.
Doris D-Day was one of my favorite singers. The movie she made with...
You know, Double D-Day when Playboy was founded.
All right. So, Brian Kiley's father...
Well, does that mean that Jugs was founded on G-Day?
So, let me start again.
Okay, Joe Cocker.
Oh, we're still on this?
Brian Kiley's father...
Mm-hmm. I'm already exhausted.
Right. Brian Kiley's father liberated Germany.
Right.
During World War II,
mm-hmm.
or WW2 for you stutterers.
I have a feeling it's going to be a long walk to the end of this pier.
Actually, the sad part is he sexually liberated Germany.
So he was willing to go to some extremes.
It was 1967.
The Germans
it was
are very kinky. Very kinky people.
Oh, yeah. He was a lot. It was very wet. Very hot.
So Brian Kiley.
So about your dating life, David. That's
Speaking of which,
Brian Kiley.
Oh my God, Brian Kiley, Brian Kiley, Brian Kiley.
Brian Kiley,
the great Brian Kiley. Oh,
legendary writer.
Brian Kiley's father.
Do you have like a neurological disorder where you can't sleep at night?
Can't stop talking about Brian Kiley.
Like you can't sleep at night if you don't finish this story. Like, in the middle of the night, you're going to wake up, Brian Kiley's father! Fuck! Alex, get in the studio!
So Brian Kiley writes for Conan. He's been on Letterman.
I'm in physical pain.
One of the best comedy writers in television, and just a great comic.
Mm-hmm.
And his father liberated the Germans during World War II.
Right. By killing them.
Liberated the Germans from World War II?
Yes.
By killing them. But he liberated them from breathing and you know, having families and seeing their children again. That kind of thing. Really great guy.
He's part of the greatest generation.
Right, of murderers. Go ahead.
Battle of the Bulge.
Uh-huh. Yeah, well, tell me about it.
Ack.
Dude, after that election, I lost the Battle of the Bulge. We'll say that.
Anyway, so after World War II, he got married.
This is the father of Brian Kiley.
Yeah, and then Brian was born.
Wow, okay. Great story, man.
Okay.
Now I know how Brian was born. Can I call him and
sounds
and
like Brian
tell him the
Kiley's
news?
Dad got his dick wet.
Yeah, now, David.
Yeah, go ahead. What?
The harder he laughs at those jokes, right. The less he thinks he has to answer them.
I know.
Full court press.
So
it's
Brian,
a deal.
Anyway, I'm telling you.
So does Brian know this story?
Yes, it's a great story. Brian.
Wow, that is a great story. His father got married and had a kid.
Now, what is the river called again? So I can get the punch.
The Spray.
No, but the other one. The Elbe?
The Elbe?
The Elbe.
And there's the Rhine. But are you talking about?
I'm trying to get to Brian Kiley's great story. About his father.
Is Brian here to tell
the story? Is so I can't give you the accurate German river.
Well, the punch.
How about the Mosel?
Is Brian coming in to tell this story?
No, I'm just going to.
Well, then why are you telling this story?
Because it's a great story. There's a river called Mosel in Germany. There's a river called Mosel?
Yeah, Mosel. It's where a lot of the, Riesling wines?
I know of them.
Yeah. A lot of them are made along the Mosel River.
But there's a Mosel in Iraq.
No, that's Mosul. This is Mosel.
Oh. Did you know that Brian Kiley's father is a war hero?
I know that I'm about to kill myself.
Colleen's about to liberate this conversation.
I'm liberate myself from breathing.
All right, so all over the Germans.
Let me just get this story. So
he busted a nut.
Yeah, he busted a nut.
So Pearl Harbor happened December.
Pearl 7th. What?
Harbor.
Dude, I went to fucking Pearl Harbor. Fucking bam those Japs.
Well, Brian's father was from Boston. As a matter of fact, I know.
I was doing a hilarious Boston accent.
So December 7th, 1941, a day that will live
in infamy.
Mm-hmm.
So
I think this conversation
will live in infamy.
I'm telling Brian's story.
How much longer is it? How much longer is it?
How soon until it's over? It's an interesting story.
Okay, how long is it, though?
It's a very short...
See, remember when that man harassed you about how long and boring your podcast was?
Uh-huh.
And you told him you could have the fast-forward mechanism? I'm going to fast-forward to the end where you tell the joke.
You know, Colleen, I don't know about you. This is why I can't have a kid.
Yeah.
Because the minute that kid came home from school and started telling a fucking 20-minute story about some bug he saw in the schoolyard after school, I'd be like, no. I'm going to teach you a little something about getting to the punchline.
Yep. Yeah. Or like when kids make up just like bullshit out of their imagination. They're like, and you know what? Because the tree wanted to stand by the fire hydrant and be an ant. And also, then Superman was there. I'm like, no.
Oh, it's a good thing I love my
nephew.
I was
like, you're losing me.
If I did not love my nephew, I would never see him because I would be like, come back when you're 18 and have a formed personality.
Yeah. You know what? Let's try to craft this narrative a little more sharply.
So this is what David's doing with this story about Brian Kiley's father.
He's got like, the ant, he's got the fire hydrant, he's got Superman.
So Brian Kiley, right? He has a father, right? And his father got married and had kids and he went to Germany and he liberated it?
It's a brief story.
How necessary was the detail?
How allegedly brief it?
I have to know. How necessary was the detail that he then got married and had Brian?
Okay,
seems
so
superfluous.
Thank you.
Does that bring us to the point?
Long.
Is that part of the thing where Brian is like, just in case you didn't know, I was born.
Liam, should you and I be teaching essay writing to high schoolers?
To David.
All right. So long story short. Long story short. The Japanese.
I give this essay an F.
The Japanese.
Minus.
In fact, I'm going to need to see your parents, David, because quite frankly.
After class.
When is parent teacher day? Because quite frankly, this story is bullshit.
So the Japanese.
And it's not even your story.
David is an exceedingly bright young man.
No, he's not.
He has a wonderful creativity and often seeks unusual solutions to fairly straightforward problems. However, he has a tendency to monopolize class conversation.
You know what my teacher said on my report card? Plays well with others, if by others you mean penis. We wish he could stop.
Heyo, ladies and gentlemen.
So the Japanese attacked Pearl Harbor.
Those dirty yellow
Japs. Wait, how are they related to Brian Kiley?
Because what happened after Pearl Harbor was...
Yes, my uncle died in Pearl Harbor.
Really?
Yes.
Yeah, his plaque is on the wall.
Yeah. His plaque. My great-uncle Don, Nair.
Don...
N-E-H-E-R.
I got all excited because I thought he invented the Nair hair removal.
No, but apparently my great-grandfather had a neighbor named Mr. Gillette who offered to let him invest $500 in his new safety razor company.
Oh, that story. I've heard that story 100 times.
Yeah, you know what? My family has a version of that, too, where my great-aunt Marge Donahue was friends with the Crocs in Florida, and they were like, hey, we're
building crock pots.
We're going to make...
We have this new thing called a crock
David,
pot.
David, I'm telling a story.
See, you would make a good mom.
I would be a mean mom.
I would be the dad.
I'd be the mean mom that like they didn't would love daddy better.
I would be the fun dad because I would be gone most of the time.
Mm-hmm.
But the time I was there, I'd be like, hey, we're going to Disneyland. Okay, now I'm going to let your mom raise you.
So they had an opportunity to invest in McDonald's.
Yeah, he was like, I'm going to make a hamburger restaurant that's like a drive-thru, only you go inside.
Uh-huh.
Or something like that. Or no. He was like, it's going to be a hamburger restaurant, but you can drive through in your car. And Marge Donahue was apparently like, Ray, that's a terrible idea. Who would want to eat a meal in their car? Allegedly.
Allegedly.
Mm-hmm. Well, my mother used to date a guy named Ken Lay.
Of Lay's potato chips?
No, from Enron. And Ken.
Oh, Ken Lay.
Yeah, and Ken gave her, she was, my mom is great.
Wait, is this for real?
This is true. My mom is great in bed. And Ken Lay.
Ken was getting his dick wet.
Ken Lay.
Speaking of which, David, so are you, so.
Hang on, Ken Lay said.
Are you dating anybody?
He said, that Lay was so good, I'm going to give you stock in Enron. And my mother sold it. And I'd hate to think if she had held on to that Enron stock, what it'd be worth today.
Wait, why the Lay pun inside that Enron story, chilling though it was?
Because the guy who ran Enron was named Ken Lay.
Yeah, but then you said that was such a great Lay. You made like a Lay.
A lame, yeah. Anyway, so back to Brian Kiley's story.
Well, you know, the thing is, when my great uncle died at Pearl Harbor, all the family members were offered $10,000 by the government, but only my uncle took them up on it.
Really?
He started a business with it, and the rest of the family held it against him because they said
it was blood money?
Yeah, it was blood money. They didn't want to touch it.
And that business was Xerox.
Dude, if I was in talking terms with my uncle who ran Xerox, I would definitely not be here right now. I'd be on an island.
My grandfather died at Pearl Harbor. You know what his last words were?
Glub, glub. That's my Whitney Houston punchline. What were Whitney Houston's last words? Glub, glub.
So, all right, anyway, so the Nazis...
David died at Pearl Harbor, but there's a comedy club there now. It's a whole other...
So the Nazis, without America...
Oh, the story's still going on.
Oh, my God.
Hitler declared war on America after Pearl Harbor.
Right.
America wasn't going to go fight Hitler until Hitler declared war. So Brian's father joined up. Mm-hmm. To liberate the Germans from the Germans, mm-hmm. and was in the Battle of the Bulge. Mm-hmm. So 50 years later, Brian's father is vacationing in Florida, and he meets a young German, because Germans like to visit Florida.
Uh-huh. Why, to see lots of Jews, like in the olden days? Germans don't like Florida. They like Texas.
They go to
for real.
No, the Irish like Florida.
No, the Germans like Florida because
the Irish like Florida.
They don't know what an old Jew looks like.
Okay, better.
Colleen, I'm just
better
letting
than
this,
my joke.
You know, I'm letting this ride because I really would love to just get on with life.
I really want to find out who David is dating. I need to find out
Brian's
more about
father. Brian's father goes to Florida. He meets a young German.
He meets a young German,
and the young German says to Brian's father, Brian's father, have you been to Germany? And Brian's father said, I only got as far as the Elbe. That's pretty funny.
I don't know.
I don't understand that joke.
It was a joke about how far his infantry unit got during the World War II.
Did you get that joke from Humor in Uniform from Reader's Digest?
Well, when Brian Kiley tells it, it's hysterical.
Well, Brian's funny.
I don't know. I am experiencing
such a profound sense of disillusionment and disappointment.
You know, this reminds me.
Maybe I dragged the story.
The best part of that joke was because they'd never seen old Jews.
Well, it was the journey.
This reminds me.
You know what? It most assuredly was not the journey.
Wait a second. This reminds me of my grandfather.
Hang on for 1 second.
Right. Fuck Brian Kiley. I don't give a shit about him.
Fuck Brian Kiley.
I like Brian Kiley a lot. Let's not
kill Brian Kiley.
No. I like Brian
a lot. Kiley.
That fucking story sucked.
Well, listen. David, when you told that
show, fuck Brian Kiley.
When you told that story,
you ruined your.
No, that's a shitty story.
It reminded me of when my father.
I'm pissed off at him now.
When my grandfather would tell stories, but after he had two strokes.
It's a two-stroke rule.
So, David, when you go, on a date, where do you take a lady?
Do you go out to dinner? Bingo.
Bingo. Take dinner.
Mm-hmm. Like what kind of restaurant? What level? How much money?
Are we talking Asia to Cuba? No, never would you go to that restaurant.
What's that?
Oh, it's like a very overly designed, not very good restaurant that's sort of an Asian fusion mess like, where is it? Like Murray Hill or some nonsense.
I would say unless it has an early bird special, probably.
Are we talking, we're not going Boulay. That's too over the top.
What is
Boulay?
What's Boulay?
It's a restaurant in Tribeca.
Or Balthazar.
Like, Balthazar is like a good all-purpose restaurant.
How do you know these things?
Because we live in New York City.
Because I've lived here for fucking...
Yeah, I lived here for 40 years. I mean, 29 years.
Yeah, I've lived here for 28 years.
Yeah. Yeah, it's like you get to occasionally...
Go like, outside and do things.
You're like occasionally like, I'm going to spend money on my life.
Yeah.
And like do nice things that make me happy.
Yeah.
You know, like...
What does that mean?
Like tonight, I'm going to see a play.
Right.
With my husband. And mm-hmm. I'm prepared for us to get dirty looks when he starts ticking and other people in the audience get mad.
And but, tonight I'm going to, with some friends, to see Fate of the Furious.
Very good.
And then I'm doing a show at QED at 11 o'clock.
Very good.
Mm. Okay.
So let me ask you something, David.
Yes, sir.
I think I made a mistake once. I met a woman I really liked. And uh-huh. I was like a little too fucking into impressing her.
Uh-huh.
So I took her to a Broadway play because I was like, well, you know, she's just moved here from somewhere else. And so we went to the TKTS booth. And this is a good third date, I realized.
Uh-huh.
Wait, hang on. That's something I wouldn't do.
What, go to the TKTS
that
booth?
I would have to know her for a while.
Well, I made the mistake. So I was like, I'll tell you what. We'll go to the TKTS booth. We'll pick a play that's on sale and we'll just go.
Mm-hmm.
I went to see a musical, but it's like 4 hours of not talking to each other. It's like a really horrible way to get to know somebody.
Right. Yeah.
So,
but
yeah.
Also 4 hours is like too long for a musical.
Well, 3 hours, whatever.
4 hours of not talking to each other.
3 hours, whatever.
You might as well get married.
Well, here's the thing, though.
I feel like you should send your listeners a David Feldman joke construction magnetic kit.
Yep.
And then everything would end with divorce or marriage.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Or everybody is in a writing room, right, Colleen?
Everyone is not in a writing room, technically.
No, but in a writing room, the rule is gay or fat.
No, gay, I think, is out.
Well, no, you were throwing shade, which is the gay show, so probably it was out at your show.
I think it's out in general.
Well, David's out in
general.
I
think that's a stale thing.
Like, see, I called him gay. That's pretty funny.
Yeah.
Because it's so shameful to be gay.
Right, you see, because...
Well, what were the room jokes at throwing shade?
There were almost none. I mean, it was like a pretty... Like,
professional operation?
Yeah. I mean,
how do you waste time?
We didn't.
But what kind of show is that?
A normal show where there's not a lot of extroverts. It was delightful.
Wait a second. Nobody was like on an assembly
doing
line
bits? No.
Blowing a guy?
No.
Nobody screamed at you about 9/11 for
no,
3 hours?
No, there were a lot of...
I had that.
Me too.
There were a lot of Cate Blanchett inside jokes, deep cuts. There were a lot of 70s cinema references.
Yeah, that's the gay show. That's the thing. Like, you probably...
It was gay men and women.
Yeah.
There's a show at the height of the Cosby revelations.
Mm-hmm.
There was a show, and the boss would call a meeting, a two-hour meeting every day,
uh-huh.
to talk about Cosby and make Cosby jokes. Had nothing to do with the show, but everybody had to go in and imitate Bill Cosby.
That sounds horrible.
That sounds hilarious.
It does sound kind of funny.
It was like Cosby meeting.
I'm just not into room bits. I
wait. So he.
But what's the point of being a comedy writer if you're not into room bits? That's the whole.
Well, that's
point.
For comedy performers.
But because the show is irrelevant. Oh, you were a head writer. You're a head writer.
You know the thing
that
was,
doesn't mean anything though.
You know what, David? Was in the room.
I hate wasting time. I'm fucking right. German.
You're writing
like
for
television.
You're writing for television. You're already wasting time.
Yeah, but I like to waste time on my schedule.
You know what, David? Here's the thing. So, David, I can see it now. She, when she was in the room,
here's what
it
I
was
am
all
a
work.
Disciplined writer who fucking gets shit done.
Yeah. So she, when
that,
she was,
that's not that's when, what's the point?
No, you know what? You got corners right now. The corners of your mouth are turning up. So I know you're not even believing what you're saying
no,
right now. This is a pile of horseshit.
No,
you
isn't.
And I have both discussed off the air. Yes, I'm blowing up your spot about how there's tumblers and typers, how there's extroverts in the room who do room bits and da-da-da-da-da, how Mel Brooks on your show of shows was a tumbler, and then how
and,
there's
and,
typers
and disliked,
who are more
and disliked.
Yes, because everyone else was a typer, an introvert who, you know,
right.
turns ideas and thoughts and words around in their minds.
Neil Simon.
Like a Rubik's Cube. You're Neil Simons.
But I told
you're
that
Woody
to you.
Allen.
I told that to you in privacy.
See?
I told that to you as a...
I've told other people writers who I trust and like.
I confided in you.
You never told me that.
I told you two things not to tell anybody.
But it never came up between us, though.
I told you not to tell anybody about that person I murdered in Thailand.
Well, it was a hooker, so it's not really a person.
Well, that's...
I did tell.
Thank you for saying that, because I'm riven with guilt, and...
That dent you have from the ping pong ball ricocheting.
Technically, it was self-defense.
That forehead dent.
Your Honor.
That dent will never go away, so you've been punished enough. It clearly says, you know.
See, but I guarantee
Bangkok
you.
Ping pong ball manufacturing co. Inc.
See, but
that's on you.
I guarantee you.
That's literally on you.
Colleen was a head writer where when she was in the room, it was all business and everyone got to work. And then as soon as she left, people were like, all right, now let's talk about what we watched last night.
Can I tell you? The hosts were very disciplined. I mean, it was like fucking breakneck making those episodes. It was a really, really small staff. We were just fucking cranking shit out all the time. Mm. And like, you know, we also didn't really know each other very well. I feel like you can do room bits once you have some familiarity or whatever.
What's the best room bit you ever heard, David?
The room bits, there was a guy named Jose Arroyo. We used to do room bits.
Great writer.
Yes.
Conan guy, too.
So when everybody was doing porn titles, there was a period, right? This was before Colleen was born, but everybody
it was definitely not, I assure you.
But there was a time, so I said, well, enough with the porn titles, and then I would shout.
You did not say that.
Yes, I did.
And then you would shout out your own porn titles.
No, then I would say, okay, I want the titles of movies about dead babies.
Uh-huh.
And Jose Arroyo said, Dumb and Dumpster.
See, the look in Colleen's...
Not Dump and Dumpster?
Dumb and Dumpster. And that was the game we used to play on the show that I worked on. We'd come up... I would usually be the one who would call out the... Instead of a porn title, you had to come up with movie titles based on, you know, Holocaust themes and that kind of stuff. So
the look on Colleen's face is just like, that would not fly in my writing room.
I'm just like, my thing is, do you want to write? Like, why is everything a competition? Like, let's just fucking get things
done
so we can
go home. That's how efficient she is. She won't even say un.
No, I'll save a syllable. I don't give a fuck.
In fact, the leader of Korea just took that syllable. Un.
That was a long walk to the end of that pier.
That sputtered worse than the last missile he fired.
Awful. Just oof.
I feel like this show just took a
God
turn.
God bless this effort, but here's the thing. You want to assume that I'm not fun in a room.
I love you. I'm begging you to come here every day.
No, you're not.
Yes, I am.
You've been having famous people. You can do a lot better than me, bro.
No, I can't.
You had Mr. Methane, all right?
Mr. Methane.
Mr. Methane, I apologize. The farter.
Yes.
Did he fart in here?
It was on the phone.
Oh, did he fart into the phone?
He phoned it in.
No, I'm serious. Did he fart into the phone?
No, I wouldn't allow that. I actually interviewed him as though he were a musician, and we talked about the instrument and how he preps, and I found out, don't do that. There wasn't one of those. There wasn't. Stop, please, don't. And it turns out, is that a queef?
No, it was a fart, but it was like one of those, I just had some red cabbage type farts, but like I also ate other food, so it's like kind of stuck in there.
All right, so.
It's like a little release of
and
air.
And it's about to get wet, like.
And I found out that Mr. Methane
was related to Brian Kiley. Oh no!
And his father liberated Mr. Methane from Auschwitz. He was gassing the Jews, Mr. Methane. So, a lot of people don't know this. Mr. Methane misrepresents himself. It turns out, this is, if you listen to my interview, Brian...
Not going to happen.
No, I think I skipped that one.
It turns out he breathes through his down under.
You mean his bunghole?
His bunghole.
That's impossible.
That he can.
I can understand where you could have muscle control where you could like open it up.
Right, but
he inhales through his diaphragm.
That's unlikely.
I'm telling you the truth. And he said... He said he discovered from his sister. He was doing yoga with his sister, and he realized he could breathe in.
By creating a vacuum of sorts.
Yes.
Mm. Oh, okay. So, but he doesn't, like, breathe. Like it,
no, but he no, can... Okay. He
it's
can
not going all the way up to his lungs.
Yeah, yeah, okay, yeah, okay.
He's quote-unquote breathing, yeah.
Okay. Right. He's breathing in...
I know how
and
anatomy
so
works.
Technically, it's not methane. It would be nitrogen and oxygen. It would
right,
be,
it would just be air.
It would be air. Mm-hmm. So he misrepresents himself.
Mm.
It's not methane.
Mm.
Although, aren't there not technically trace elements of methane
when I'm
in
a
all
room,
the air we breathe?
Especially when I'm in a room.
Well, don't I know it, brother.
Now, let me ask you a question.
Yes.
I don't think we need this National Enquirer gimmick.
I was going to read you some
I've
items.
Never been on your show when one of these bits worked. But go ahead.
What bit?
What bit, he says, fiendishly flipping through a National Enquirer so he can bait us with nonsensical bullshit.
I was...
Let's talk about, like, chefing and restauranting and shit like we were going to talk, like we were talking about before, because that was fun.
Okay, we had Jeremiah Tower on the show.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
You guys know food. I don't know food. Your dad was a chef?
Yes.
Is a chef.
Well, he's retired now, but yeah, he was a culinary instructor my whole
from
life.
From Germany,
growing up.
So
yeah.
He really knew his way around the ovens.
Thank
yes.
you.
Thank
you know, the difference between a pizza and a Jew, right? pizza doesn't scream when you put it in the oven.
You do? It does.
I made Jackie the Joke Man very
hang
angry
on, a
by
pizza
telling
does,
him that joke.
A pizza does scream if you put it in an oven, if the topping is a live baby. So that joke is not only anti-Semitic,
it's also Baroque in its construction, in its desperation to top
that joke
Mr. McEneaney.
That joke, David, was dumb and dumpster.
Yeah, that one needs to go into the toilet at prom, that one.
So go ahead.
It's a New Jersey dumpster.
So you grew up around food.
I did. I grew up around chefs. One of my favorite things was when we would have a day off of school, if it was, you know, one of those...
Do they have
teacher
snow days
conference?
In Minnesota?
Oh, yeah.
I thought they would have no snow days in Minnesota, where they canceled school because there was no snow.
But, yeah, I would go with my dad to his work sometimes, and I still have, like, really warm and fuzzy memories of, like, giant industrial Hobart mixer and, like, when they would do butchery days, when they would butcher a side of beef.
You mean
like,
the, way David butch-
a bandsaw.
The way David butchered
just
Brian
butchered
Kiley's
that pizza
story?
Joke? Yeah. And right, and the Brian Kiley story.
I used every part of that joke and that story.
Yes. But it's so more ahead. Like it, yeah. The effect was more like Scrapple, not like not like high-end offal right. Repurposing at some hip Brooklyn boite.
You know how when you're poor and you eat supermarket brand hot dogs?
Uh-huh.
That was David using every part of Brian Kiley's story.
Right.
Hey, fuck like, Brian Kiley, man. That story sucks. That guy has Emmys and
hey,
fucking
you...
writers. Now, hang on for 1 second. Brian Kiley is one of the most respected comedy writers in the business. Emmys, Writers Guild Awards. He's been on Letterman.
He's my parents' favorite comedian.
We
no
get
right.
it.
And his fucking story sucked. He killed the show. Fuck it, Brian
Do you
Kiley.
Have as much reach as like Rwandan radio did in the 90s?
Well, yes.
Asking for a friend.
You know what? Yes. In that, when people hear oh, the show, they cut
they
their own...
They turn violently murderous?
They cut their own heads off.
With a machete? I regret to inform you that I will be killed and will kill my own family tomorrow.
So go ahead.
So that was a deep cut Philip Gravich joke in case anybody
of deep
was
cuts.
Wondering.
I didn't get it. You know what? I'll cop to the fact I didn't understand that. But you know what?
That was a deep cut in Rwanda,
you know, Colleen,
too.
Yeah.
Colleen, I trusted you.
Thank you.
I trust you that. That was funny.
It was.
So go ahead. Your father used to
you know,
butcher.
Unlike David, I think you're actually a lot of fun in a room.
Thank you.
I know David doesn't really like think.
David thinks that I'm a stern taskmaster.
Yeah, like a...
No, I don't.
Well, then, can a bitch tell us that? Can a bitch get a sip of coffee before she gets kicked in the vag every time she opens her goddamn mouth?
Problem with Colleen in a writer's room is every time she leaves and closes the door, people start looking for spigots for ass to
So your father used to take...
Because they're all Jews in the
Your room. Father used to take... On butcher day, he would cut up Tutsis or Hutus?
Now this is getting too mixed up.
Okay, so... All right, so you're
Now
growing...
this is just like a... It's You know what? It's like a dish with too many flavors. Everything yes. is getting muddled.
Okay, so you would have, there would be a snow day. So
yeah.
Your father would take you to work.
Yep.
And he taught cooking. He was a...
Yeah.
at the Culinary Institute in Minnesota.
It was called St. Paul Technical Vocational School, but it was one of the only like programs in the Twin Cities where you could learn how to become a professional chef.
Right.
But he cut his teeth as a chef. In
luxury,
this joke is not worth it. I can tell already. I can tell already.
She said cut his teeth as a chef.
You're literally just taking up space with like annoying high pitched noises.
You know what it is? David's afraid people will forget this is his podcast.
Yeah.
No, I wish, like, I wish they would. I wish
they'll be like, wow, this Colleen podcast turned very interesting. Oh, it's David.
Okay. All right, so your father cut his teeth as a chef.
Right.
In, like,
after he
fancy
pulled the teeth of the Jews
right,
in Germany.
Exactly.
And you'll notice I didn't make a joke about cutting the teeth.
Well, just I applaud your restraint, David.
Let's just say he has a collection of
teeth.
Can
a bitch finish a story? I'll ask once again.
He has a jar full of gold teeth. That's all we're going to say.
All right. So, your father was teaching, and he would take...
Don't even try to catch up, because your mind is whirring, just looking for any word
like
to come up with the next...
No, go ahead.
Not like a whirling dervish.
I was thinking of a blender.
No.
Hey, Alex, can we cut David's mic?
You look so smug right now. It's disgusting.
What? I want to hear the...
Here's you.
Okay, so father, daughter...
Anyway, he grew up in Germany, and then he left home when he was 14, like you do if you are on the...
Did he meet Brian Kiley's father on the way out?
No, I think only Russian soldiers ever went through their village and tried to rape my oma.
Hmm.
That's a true story. So when he left, he went to Germany and Austria and Switzerland and worked in fancy hotels and restaurants in Switzerland. And then he worked on ships that were bringing people from Europe to America. He worked in one that went from like London to Greece to Morocco to New York. He worked
cruise
on
ships.
That one. Basically, yeah.
Okay.
And then he worked for the Sheraton Ritz Hotel chain in London. He opened one in Kingston, Jamaica.
Wow.
Where he was also...
Back when that meant something, by the way.
Yeah, in the early 60s.
Noel
Coward. Well, he was Ginger Rogers and Fred Astaire's private chef when they worked on a movie down there. In Jamaica. And then he worked in the Sheraton Ritz in New York on 33rd and Park, which is there no longer. But then they asked him to open up a kitchen in Minneapolis. And he thought, oh, how interesting to be in a Navy town. He thought it was Annapolis. And he got there and he was like, oh, no. But then he met my mom, who was a beautiful young woman, who dropped off a packet of papers at his office because she was working in catering and events planning. And they fell in love. And they got married in 68. And then 2 years later, I was born.
Hmm.
And then he decided to be a hotel restaurant chef anymore. He decided to teach so he would have better hours.
I see.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Walleye?
Why?
Walleye.
Walleye is a wonderful lake fish. Very delicate, white, and flaky. It's kind of like maybe a halibut.
Mm-hmm.
Like a freshwater halibut is what I would say.
Whenever I play Acme Comedy.
Oh, yeah. That's a delightful club.
They serve me walleye.
Mm-hmm.
When I used to eat fish.
Do you not anymore?
I don't eat fish.
Are you vegan now or something?
Well, I don't eat fish. So your father took you to school one day.
Wait a second. Are you allergic to fish?
You just
I don't want to talk about my dating life.
Well, now that you mention it, though.
Yeah.
Are you getting your dick wet?
Well, the real question is, are you getting your face wet?
Yes.
Fair point.
I appreciate the specificity of that.
I don't think David gives like that. Which is too bad.
Why would I want a woman to throw cold water in my face?
I'm talking about orally pleasing a woman with your mouth.
What do you mean?
Yeah, that was a
what do you
just
mean?
A confusing construction.
You mean telling her a joke?
See, I knew you would
I've
be
I've never known David Feldman to be so coy. He's like gathering his leg toward him, his crossed leg toward himself as though to guard his body from our onslaught of nosy questions.
Well, I mean, do you think there might be a possibility that the woman I have tied up in my basement might listen to the show?
See, that's
I
do not want to offend her.
That's a joke answer. Well, yeah. I get,
but if she listens to this podcast, is she really going to be the kind of person who's offended by things? I'm going to say no.
Yeah, considering that we just
I just destroyed.
Maybe I'm not attracted to women who find me funny.
We just went through 30.
That is between you and your analyst.
Maybe I don't like.
But that has nothing to do with our questions.
Maybe
which
in
you
moments
should answer
of
honestly.
Maybe in moments of
wow, this is very
this is
interesting.
Very telling. This
very
is so Freudian, Freudian jackpot
very
right
interesting.
Now.
What?
Because you're stumbling on the word intimacy like a rodeo clown in a mud pit.
Dude, you're stumbling on the word intimacy like a character in a sitcom that is afraid of intimacy.
Like
an 80s sitcom would be like, that might be a little too broad. Let's bring that down a little bit.
Maybe I'm not.
Okay.
Yeah.
Then why would she be listening to your podcast?
Yeah, seriously.
Why would you be dating someone who's listening to your podcast if you don't like somebody who thinks you're funny?
Well, to be honest, he hasn't been funny yet.
True.
So.
Fair.
She might think it's an NPR-type chat show.
Right. Like a fresh air.
Yeah.
Except this is like stale air.
Terry extremely
but it's gross. Musty
air. Right. Majorly gross.
But
I'm majorly gross.
But
what do you think? Go.
So you're saying you don't do that. You don't go down on a woman.
I would not. I will not discuss. What does it mean, go down? Make fun of them?
No, perform oral sex upon.
Wait a second. When has go down ever meant make
fun?
Wait,
perform oral sex on a woman. They don't have penises. I don't understand what you.
Wow.
This coy whole persona just is so ill-fitting.
Dude, why? Fred Astaire didn't tap dance
this
fast.
It's like David Byrne's suit in Stop Making Sense, yeah. R.I.P. Jonathan Demme, a great artist.
Oh, yes. My God, that was very sad.
Yeah.
So that's a no.
What's the question?
Does David Feldman go down on women? The answer we're left with is no.
Yeah, I mean, that's the only answer I have is a no.
We have no affirmative.
I can't answer that question.
Yes, you can. Technically, you can. Technically, you are capable of answering this question.
You know what we're talking about.
Don't pretend you don't know what go down on it.
You know, if I brought it up in a hilarious joking
context...
Are
you accusing me of being a black man? Is that what you're...
I'm accusing you of being coy.
You're saying...
Which is the corniest thing ever.
And putting a wall between yourself and your feelings.
And the interviewers.
Yeah. This is like...
Do you think...
Like, you're asking her about her family history, her to, like, open up to you, but you refuse to do, like, return the favor.
Where is the quid pro quo?
Yeah, exactly.
Where's the quo?
That's exactly right.
Where's the quid? I don't see no pro, neither.
Oh, shit! Hot 97, y'all!
Bling, 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 bling.
So wait a minute. you're back in New York. You're going.
I missed this.
Yeah, you're gonna come here every Saturday.
Oh God. My God, I just snotted out of my nose. I got nose juice on me. It's
you're
really cold.
You're gonna be here every
here.
Saturday, right?
No.
Yes.
No.
Yes.
No. A bitch needs to find some work. I gotta get a job, David.
I need
a goddamn job.
I want to call in for the Fred Stoller interview.
Okay, but you said I look smug.
You did before. Now you look worried.
But what do you mean I look smug?
I don't even remember what that was about.
Do I have a smug look?
Right now, no.
But what
before you did.
You know what? Now you look like a little bit upset.
Now
like,
you look upset and concerned.
Like we got really close to something true about you, and now you're just like frantically
backpedaling. Well, I don't think it's... Right. The rule that I have...
You're hamster wheeling.
You are. You really are.
Don't talk about
like
my intestines.
Polish, you're backpedaling like
intestines.
The Polish 500.
Hang on, let me explain the joke.
No, well, please, that'll make it funnier.
Okay.
You said so Brian Kiley's father.
I was kidding. I don't want you to explain
hamster
that.
Wheeling, and I said my intestines, because there's a gerbil up there. So And because I love animals, I put a wheel in my intestines.
But it only got as close as the
you're just
old.
Desperate. Your mind is overactive, and you're desperate. So you're just like firing, sparking, sputtering.
You know what it is? He's looking for anything that will turn the conversation away from the fact that
he refuses to go down on women.
Yeah, it's weird. That's like a...
Why would you say that about me?
That's a
weird...
Because
that's what we're assuming because you're playing coy with us and not answering the question. You're being evasive.
Coy?
Sketchy.
You mean like the fish?
No, bitch.
That's a poi.
C-O-Y.
What's a koi pond?
Poi.
It's a koi
pond. You are being evasive and sketchy. Don't you can't koi pond your way out of this.
Well, because I don't think.
But the thing, David, is like it's shown that it's easier for women to orgasm if men
if
go
a man
down
goes
on them
down on her
first,
yes.
and then penetrates.
But
her.
What is a women have what?
What?
Huh? Women orgasm?
You are doing such a bad job of deflecting right now.
This is fucking terrible. It's charmingly pathetic.
Do you think
we're gonna get you? We're just gonna keep on doing this.
You're giving more answers by refusing to answer.
I have a rule that, you know, I never talk about my kids or my ex-wives.
What? Well, you talk about your divorce all the time.
But I don't go into specifics.
Nobody's talking about going down on your kids. Or are we?
It's an invasion.
Don't cut that out, Alex.
I got into trouble for praising one of my kids on somebody's show. I got yelled at for talking about how.
Yelled at by whom?
By one of my kids for talking about how.
Who cares if your kids yell at you? They're supposed to yell at you.
It gets tiring after a while.
Dude, just
well, why
tell
don't you tell them to shut the fuck up and have some respect for their father?
Yeah, tell them you're not going to pay their rent anymore. They'll get in line.
Yeah, they'll fucking.
Yeah, they'll fucking
toe
get
the
in line.
Line.
Yeah, that's right.
I was never allowed to be a disciplinarian.
Allowed to be a disciplinarian?
Yeah.
No wonder your kids are so fucked up.
Dude, your kids aren't exactly the seven little foys where you're thrusting them on the vaudeville stage. I'm glad you guys get that, by the way.
I have no idea what it means, but I like the sound
Bob
of it.
Hope, the seven little foys.
That was a true story.
Yeah.
It was based on Eddie Foy. I just read his autobiography. I'm going to plug a couple books before I'm out of here.
All right.
Okay.
One is called Clowning Through Life, the autobiography of Eddie Foy, a vaudeville and Broadway star.
Ooh.
Was that the son or the father?
The father.
Or the Holy Ghost?
The father. When he was a kid, he survived the Great Chicago Fire. And then his mother was like the nursemaid for Mary Todd Lincoln. And he lived in Dodge City for 6 months and was friends with Wyatt Earp. It's an amazing book.
How much of it is actually true?
You know, I would actually...
By the way, Wyatt Earp is what Mr. Methane calls his anal larynx.
You know, every time there was like
Wyatt
something
Earp?
In this... something that Every time there was something
pronounced
in this book...
Larynx.
Some of the time there's something in this book where I was like, that can't be true. He would then reproduce like a letter from an eminent physician, or like there was a whole thing about how he was in a theater fire, basically the theater fire in Chicago that created all our fire codes in this country. Because
of all the gaslight.
Yeah, because everyone just died.
Mm-hmm.
Like, it was just 1,000 people died because so many exits were chained. But he was stood on stage and like sang to like calm people down as they exited so they wouldn't stampede each other.
Jesus Christ.
Anyways, that was a great book. And the other one is Jason Zinnemann's Letterman book.
Oh,
which,
yeah.
Which we were talking about earlier.
What's the guy's last name?
Zinnemann.
Zinnemann.
Z-I-N-O-M-A-N. I'm surprised you haven't had him on your podcast.
He writes about comedy for the Times.
We'll get him. I'm just doing a little too much comedy on
this.
He's
doing like all the bigger podcasts.
Well, what do you normally do?
Well, we've been avoiding politics. I have a little Trump fatigue.
Although I will say that Trump show is fucking funny. That president show?
I haven't seen it yet.
God, it's good.
Anthony Mananuk?
I don't know how to pronounce his last name, but his characterization of Trump is just incredible. I'm hardly saying anything that is new or original here. It's so good that he got his own show.
Right.
And does he just play Trump throughout the whole thing? It's on Comedy Central,
yeah,
right?
So
no one's seen it, but...
The first act is like at the desk. He does a desk segment.
So it's like, that's my Bush.
What was that?
It's a talk show.
Yeah. It's like as though Trump has his own late night talk show. So act one is at the desk, act two is a pre-tape, and then act three was an interview with Keith Olbermann. And then there's a little act four.
Did
outro.
Olbermann play it straight, or did he try to
he
be funny?
He tried to, but he tried to be funny, too. Yeah. He was trying to do it both ways.
Yeah.
It's like that Brian Kiley story we heard earlier.
Yeah.
Well, anyway. I have a list here from Dick Morris. You know, remember Dick Morris?
Wasn't he a speech? No.
For Clinton.
Presidential advisor?
Clinton.
Yeah, he was. Well, he was.
Then he sold them out, and he wrote like a whole... book about how evil the Clintons are.
Didn't he have hookers or something? Like he had some scandal?
Yeah,
Am I thinking about Marv Albert?
No, you're right.
You're right. Dick Morris, he would lick a hooker's feet. That's what he liked to do.
And you know what? God bless.
Yeah, whatever brings her pleasure, right, David?
Right. Go down on a woman, it makes her more likely to orgasm.
I mean, he doesn't, but if you did.
What, are you saying that there's something on a woman's toe that makes her go off?
Well, there are many nerve endings in the toes and feet. So, possibly.
Have you ever had your feet sucked, David? I had a girlfriend that liked to do that. It actually feels good.
Yeah. As have I. Only in my case, it was a boyfriend.
Right. Sucking your toes.
Yeah.
I mean, she didn't love to do it, but she started.
But that, you know what? That's an early in the relationship thing. That doesn't continue unless you're like a true foot fetishist, one would assume.
Liam, yeah, but she basically started doing it one night, and I was like, oh my God, that feels great.
Well, yep. Liam, a lot of Liam's girlfriends suck his toes because he kicks them in the mouth.
What? Wow, that got real dark.
I don't even get that. Oh, I see. Because I abuse them physically.
Yeah. You don't like that, Colleen?
I just wasn't expecting it to take that turn. I thought it was going to be like a collegial, sort of jovial, fun lift out. And instead it was just sort of a brutal, it was like a Westworld flavored gag.
Is that what happens in Westworld?
It's super violent.
Do they abuse fake prostitutes?
Oh, yeah. They're always getting like beat up and raped like all the time.
Jesus.
Well, you know what's interesting is...
Wow. And is that a comedy or is it...
No, it's a very self-serious drama.
And there are guys who want to beat up robots. That's not the same thing as beating up a real woman.
Well...
You know what the interesting thing is? So David dates a woman who doesn't want him to talk about oral sex.
Right.
But does want him to talk about kicking women in the teeth.
Interesting.
Yeah.
Well, because it's not true.
What's not true? You don't go down on women? That's not true?
No, I will not. I've never kicked a woman in the mouth.
Uh-huh.
So I can joke about it.
Allegedly.
I can joke about things that aren't true.
You know, if he pays for it.
Do not go down on women.
And do you think
you know, if he pays for it, technically they're not people in his eyes. So you can kick him in the mouth.
Right, like that Thailand hooker who hit him in the forehead with the ping pong.
That he murdered in self-defense.
My father said to me, if you can't get it up, you go down on them.
That's not true.
I'm kidding. Let me read
you. Are you, though?
What?
It had a ring of truth to it.
I was making it. I'm a very generous lover.
In that you pay them in 20s. I mean,
that's
what
great.
An elegant, simple construction.
I was going to go, I tip 50%.
Right.
But that's...
Well, that's because you're Jewish, so you only have 50% of the tip left.
Dick Morris, who is a friend of Brian Kiley's. And by the way, fuck Brian Kiley for that story. Right? It's the last time I steal a Brian Kiley.
Watch.
Stop planning for this podcast and just let it flow. Because when you let it flow, this is a great show. When you do bits and things that you thought of.
All right, I had something. All right. How much time do we have, Alex?
Half hour.
We have what? Oh, we still have more time? Right. I'm having fun.
So here's the job.
Me too. I just fogged out for a second because I'm tired.
This is hard work.
Here's the bit that David wanted to do. This is a list in the National Enquirer. And there's going to be like, oh, this is such a great list. And let me read you some stuff, Colleen. And then you're going to be like, no, this is the National Enquirer. So from jobs to trade.
Here's the thing I'll say about the National Enquirer.
It's true.
A stopped clock is right twice a day. No, don't give it away. Like, let him do his bit.
I'm deconstructing your bit, which is a lot funnier.
I don't want to be
Wait, let me just see that for a second.
Wait, so what? So I was going to be like, yuck, the National Enquirer.
Right.
I give the National Enquirer props. They broke the Gary Hart story.
And the Pizzagate story.
And the Pizzagate story.
They broke Pizzagate wasn't true, though.
It wasn't?
Allegedly.
No. Well, then I better stop posting about it on Reddit. So it's like Dick Morris wrote a column called From Jobs to Trade, Trump's Getting It Done. And then it's
where
like...
Where was the column?
In the National Enquirer.
Oh, it was for the Enquirer.
It was for the Enquirer.
And they're for Trump. And they're for Trump.
Yes, they've been for Trump since the beginning. So
because they're mobbed up.
Are they?
Mm-hmm.
So now,
by the mafia?
Mm-hmm.
Can we sidebar for one second?
Of course.
What is going on with the mafia right now? Like, is that the only thing that it's got left?
No, it's got the waterfront still.
Yeah?
I mean, the waterfronts aren't as profitable as they used to be, but, you know, there's still jobs to be had.
Okay.
You want to know what happened?
I feel like the sanitation thing is not really a thing.
You want to know what happened to the mafia?
Well, I want to see Liam's take, and then I'm going to ask you.
Okay.
Basically, like, they've been marginalized because the federal government in the 90s especially. I mean, I'm talking about, like, the Gattis and all the people in New York.
The Gambinos, the Genoveses.
Right, the ones I grew up reading about in the paper.
Right.
The Daily News was mobbed up for a long time.
Interesting.
In fact, John Gotti's widow had a 5-part column about how great he was. It's just like straight up like, this is why John Gotti was the greatest human being on earth.
I figured that it was just because like technology basically eclipsed the smartness of mafia people. Like mafia people thought that they could keep on doing their own way of doing things. But then it was like, oh, guess what, bitch? We've been surveilling you for like...
Well, no, I mean,
would you like to know the truth?
So they had people in the FBI, so they learned about, you know, surveillance technology mm-hmm. and what they could talk on and what okay. they could safely do. But, you know, like, so basically there was a lot of heat on them, and then these federal task forces broke them up, and there's a lot of,
right,
like,
they got them on RICO.
Yeah, it's a lot of stuff like that.
Would you like to know the truth?
Yeah, sure, let's do it.
Sure.
Everything Liam said mm-hmm. is what they want us to believe.
And what do you believe?
Well, Gotti was disliked because everybody knew his business. If you're in the mafia...
Because he was too much of a showboat?
Yeah. If you're in the mafia, you are not supposed to talk about it.
Omerta.
So...
Which is the code of silence.
Right. And in Albanian mafia, it's called the Besa.
The Besa. Mm-hmm. I like that better.
If you want to know what happened to the mafia...
And the Jewish mafia is called...
they're sitting in the Situation Room at the White House. That's what happened to the mafia. It's, Donald Trump.
Actually, Trump...
You cannot pour cement.
Okay, now we're getting Trump into crazy
is,
town.
No, Trump is mobbed up, but I don't think they're in the Situation Room.
Roy Cohn?
Roy Cohn is dead, dude.
No. Trump has been photographed with known mafia figures.
You can't pour cement.
Oh, no, I know. You can't do construction in New York without
right.
the mob, obviously.
And
but that's like low-level mob.
And,
right.
of course, Atlantic City owning the Taj Mahal.
Right.
He was the only one in Atlantic City right. who wasn't working with Nicky Scarfa.
So tell me, how does dropping a bomb on ISIS benefit the mafia?
Yeah.
How does building a wall benefit the
but
mafia?
But you know what? I feel like we're just like baiting the hook.
Right. What's it called? Mother of all bombs.
Mother of all bombs.
You know about Italian men and mothers.
So what is this list that you... This great... I'm sorry I deconstructed
your
bit.
No, I
apologize.
You weren't talking about the mafia. The fact is that the mafia, it's evolution. Excuse me for one second, okay?
Are we going to get to Bush and Gore and like the fucking war in Iraq? Because I will kill myself immediately.
No. When the Italians...
So Brian Kiley's father.
When the Italians came to America, they had a...
They had a spicy meatball.
They had to work with the Jews because...
That's a nice donut.
They needed the Jews to do the math. They needed Meyer Lansky to do the math.
That's not true at all.
No, otherwise
there would be Chinese people in the mafia.
Well, there are. And what happens is...
Well, just a different mafia.
The Tongs.
The Italian mafia through evolution, and it's even spoken about in
I'm
Godfather
so glad you're
3.
Here, Colleen, because sometimes I'm on the show with another guest that just lets it slide.
Where did
and
Michael,
I'm like, you know what? I don't want to fight this
Where did
alone.
Michael Corleone go to college?
I don't know, because you know
Dartmouth.
What? I don't fucking care about the Godfather bullshit.
That was a fictional
character.
No, yeah, the point character. Puzo was making is that they...
Is that he wasn't smart enough to get into Princeton, Yale, or Harvard.
Bling, bling, bling. Morning with Colleen and David.
Look at my smug. Is this a smug look?
No, it just looks like you're adjusting your beanie in an uncomfortable way.
I look smug?
Why
smarter.
Are you wearing a beanie?
I've been in the woods for a couple of days.
But it's like literally 82 degrees outside right now.
I am going to get back to grooming tomorrow.
Is something going on with your hair transplants?
No, I'm not groomed.
I'm
today.
Going bald. I'm just fucking letting it
All
go.
All right, so...
Look at me. I got like 2 inches of gray roots here. Look at this.
Gray Roots.
Not good.
That was the sequel to...
it's all the characters from Roots, but they're all like right. 80 yeah. to 100 uh-huh. years old.
No, they're all aliens.
What's my name? Kunta Kinte. No, I can't remember. What's my name? Because he's got Alzheimer's.
Right.
So this list, Gray Roots. That. So Dick Morris put a list together.
No,
we're
the mafia,
read it together.
What happens is the mafia children get smart. They get educated.
Right, your Hunter Sopranos, your right. Meadow Sopranos.
All your fictional characters.
And then they go off to college, but they're still criminals,
right.
but now they're working in the Justice Department, or they're working in the right. FBI, and
but
they're
actually,
working in corporate America.
Actually, there are thugs, and they do the same thing their fathers did.
They do. They're thugs. They're corporate thugs. And you know what? Corporate thugs are much more dangerous than Lucky Luciano. Lucky Luciano, they only killed their own.
But here's another
corporate
question.
Thugs kill okay, all of us.
You know what?
Okay, Huffington
No,
Post.
I gotta. You know what, Colleen? I gotta say, this time it took 75 minutes for David to get to corporate America
right.
and the conspiracy.
And
it's
not a conspiracy.
And I applaud you for your restraint. I'll say that. I applaud you for your restraint.
About cutting
Boy,
his teeth?
If only St. Bernie
your
had
dad
been
cut his teeth? That was restraint. For me not to do a joke about your father cutting his teeth.
Oh, we're getting real now. We're getting real
Do you know
now.
How much respect I have for you to hold back?
You actually did make a joke, though.
No, I said that there's an area for a joke. But
yeah, but that's a passive-aggressive way to, like, make
also,
a
you
joke.
Couldn't, no, you couldn't think of a good joke, but you claim that so right. that you could come back
you
later.
Claim, you, like, put, like, right. a post-it on yeah. it to come back to later, which is now.
Right. You put a pin in that map so that you could be like, okay, that's my territory.
I'm not...
That's my territory.
I sell
the jukeboxes to the boss.
I break the toms. I had a cutting a fart joke, by the way, off the cutting...
A few people at home.
You're an 8-year old skill.
I hope people could at home could see the look of pain on Colleen's face.
No, I had a cutting the cheese joke and a cutting a fart joke when you said your father cut his teeth at the.
Do you still miss me, David?
Why are you bragging about this?
Well,
you think I'm going to respect you?
I showed you restraint. I didn't do a cutting cheese. He cut his teeth.
All right, but you're playing it both ways by saying the joke. And trying to get credit for not saying
it. I want credit for not doing a cutting a cheese joke when we're doing a joke about cutting.
This is some just the tip bullshit.
$3 billion in fines for illegal imports.
Don't do my bit.
Look at what a childish man you are, yanking the Inquirer out of Liam McEneaney's hands.
Of course I go down on women.
We got him! We got him! Yay! Yay! High five. High five. All right, high five for you too. Yay! That was a really weak one. You got to redo it. Oh, yeah. No. Look, you got to look at the hand. There you go. Okay, now we just did solid high fives.
All right, there we go.
All right, now I feel completeness.
All right. What are you,
we done now?
What do you think I am?
I don't know what you are.
I was sitting here when Robert Smigel was on the show.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And he was sitting where you are, Colleen. And David had a whole bit planned for that. And then Robert, while eating a lox on a bagel, sat there and just kind of quietly deconstructed what was so about. Like, what was the bit? Like, you were going to act like you didn't know who he was or something like that?
Ugh.
And then he just kind of deconstructed what was supposed to be funny about that.
It was pretty funny.
It was very funny.
Yeah. That seems to be the deconstruction chair. You're in the deconstruction chair.
Yeah, you're in, like, the comic genius with no
it's
patience.
It's like the catbird seat of comedy.
The bit was that Robert Smigel came in. It was a year ago. And I brought in all these young comedy writers. And I set this up. Where I said,
and it made for a great show because they were all afraid to talk to Robert Smigel.
I'm sure they were feeling completely like constricted and like fearful of fucking up.
The bit was
like I was the only one who felt comfortable talking to him because I'd met him before.
The bit was that I was putting myself on the same level as Robert, so I was saying we're talking to young comedy writers. I'm sure they have a lot of questions for me and Robert. You know, I have this podcast, so I'll answer your question.
But what you were doing was like a weird inside baseball thing where like they can't really tell the difference because they're like
no,
two
I told them
respected
before,
comics.
Right. I told them there were five comedy writers here. And before the bit started, before Robert walked into the room,
right.
I said, just ask Robert questions, obviously. And I'll keep saying, does anybody have any questions for me?
Oh, okay.
Right. And then right before the show, David panicked and told Robert everything.
No, because they wouldn't do it. They wouldn't do the bit.
So Robert's sitting there like, yeah, so what we're doing right now is... so they're asking questions, and I'm acting like I don't...
Are we suddenly doing like a New York Magazine recap of this very podcast? The podcast?
This is so meta, in a
horrid way.
Welcome to Talking Feldman, the after show for the podcast.
How is this not hosted by Chris Hardwick?
We should do an after show. This feels like this was an after show. This was like Colleen is back and Liam's back.
Before we wrap it up.
Do you still miss me? Or
I do, of course. Okay, this was the most fun I've had.
I don't believe that.
Since you don't think I had a good time?
No, I believe you had a good time, but I feel like you've had a really good time lately with lots of delightful guests.
I think this is the most fun
it's
he's had.
Not a competition.
Most fun he's had since the last time he spent 90 seconds going down on a woman before demanding a blowjob. It's like, oh, God, I hope that was good for you. Let's do this. Is this going to happen now?
Let's do this thing.
Dude, my friend was just telling me that his friend like hung out with Marky Mark and the Funky Bunch back in the day.
Yes.
She's like an attractive young woman.
Uh-huh.
They went to some like room where there was a mattress, and she was sitting next to Marky Mark.
Some room with a mattress.
It sounded awful.
Oh, God bless.
And so Marky Mark turned to her and said, so this is going to happen now? And then she went down on him.
Wow, interesting.
And she told you that.
On the mattress?
She told my friend that. Yeah, on the mattress.
Wow.
And why would a woman do that?
Because he was ripped, first of all. He was a Calvin Klein model, so he was a very attractive
man.
I
suppose it's, you know, a decent cocktail party anecdote for later on.
I'll say cocktail.
I don't get it.
That's not what I heard.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, girl.
Womp, womp.
Why would a woman do that?
You tell me, David.
I know why a guy would go down on Marky Mark. That I understand.
You have to ask Colleen why a lady would do that.
What did I say?
I, sir, am no lady. You know what? This is boring. I don't want to speak for all women.
All right.
Hey, Colleen, can you do me a favor and just check this list in the National Enquirer for a minute?
All right. Before we go.
No, because he's going to snatch it out of my hands like a vulture.
Snatch.
Speaking of
snatch, David Feldman and his dating life.
Is that a haircut?
That's a pube in his throat.
Like, oh God, how long? My jaw is so tired. It's been 15 seconds, David.
You're only at my navel.
Yeah. Oh, my knees are numb. Oh, David, it's been like...
It's all that gardening you were doing before.
Yeah.
We're just reading.
Yeah.
We're sitting in chairs reading.
David looks up after 90 seconds. She's on the phone with her friend.
I put a New York Times crossword puzzle on her navel. And...
Again, I'm just laughing at the look on Colleen's face.
I know. The funny, that's the sad thing about this show, is nobody can see Colleen.
Just how dismay.
The dismay. We should do a game show where
I finished the motherfucking crossword today in 21:21.
You are so
bullshit.
Smart.
No.
Saturday?
Do you time yourself?
Yeah.
That's crazy.
I time myself every Saturday.
That's crazy.
But that's not my record, though.
What's your record?
My record, which admittedly is an outlier, is 9 minutes and 36 seconds.
I'll say it's a liar.
You're so smart.
But that was a mega easy one. Even Rex Parker, who does the Rex Word blog about the New York Times crossword puzzle, said it was an easy.
What's the record?
All-time record?
Mm-hmm.
I think some of the like super champion people can do it in like under a minute.
What?
Yeah.
You're so
but
smart.
They do it online. They type it.
Oh, then,
I do it in pen.
Yeah, no, you got it. Oh, you do it in pen.
Mm-hmm.
No pencil.
No.
When you're a smart...
Because...
I'm going to ask you a question. Because all kidding aside, because I asked Jeremiah Tower this question.
Mm.
You can spot somebody who has taste. He says he knows who has taste and who doesn't.
Thank you.
Okay.
And you're really bright. Do you know who's smart and who isn't? Can you say...
No.
But
generally,
you know that you're smart.
I think I'm reasonably smart. I wish I had had a better education than I did. And I had a pretty good one. But I wish I had had
You're
a
so smart.
Even
so how, like, how many books do you read a week?
Not sometimes none. Sometimes...
Are you able to read even when you're angry, pissed off, or depressed?
No. No. If I am emotionally preoccupied, I have a really hard time doing anything.
Do you veg in front of the TV?
No, I actively watch TV.
And what do you watch shit or only good stuff?
So the only kind of like actively garbagey show I like is those competitions like American Ninja Warrior and things like that, where or like Wipeout.
Do you watch sports?
No.
Do you follow sports?
Sometimes I'll watch like rodeos, like bull riding and stuff like that, but I really don't.
That's interesting.
Do you pay attention to things because everybody else is paying attention to them, or do you pay attention only to things you're interested in?
If I'm like, oh, why is everyone? Why, oh, I hadn't planned. Like, I felt that way about Big Little Lies. Everyone was talking about it, and I was like, I thought it looked bad, but maybe it's interesting. And I watched it, and I'm actually glad I did.
So you pay attention to the cultural waves.
I do.
And you're influenced by what's around you.
Define influenced.
In other words, you will say what you just said. People are interested in this, mm-hmm. so I should give it a shot.
If everyone is like down on a thing, I won't watch it. If it's wildly half yes, half no, I will watch it because I like things that are not controversial, but now, that
David,
people have wildly different opinions.
Will you watch a show?
David, do you need to clarify what down on a thing is?
Will you watch a show mm-hmm. knowing that you're only going to watch one episode of it, even though you're going to love it? Do you feel bad that you catch one episode of something that's important, but you know you don't have the time to finish it?
I always have time. I make time for programs. I love my programs.
And what are your programs?
Well, The Americans right now, obviously. RuPaul's Drag Race, which admittedly is a bit of a lighter watch. I like MasterChef Junior. I don't really like regular MasterChef anymore, but I like the MasterChef Junior because I like the kids.
I saw Irregular MasterChef, where they cook food that isn't...
Irregular is clothing, not food.
No, I was going to make a constipation joke.
Oh,
Can I ask you...
I want to do a
Are you recruiting her for Scientology
Am I being recruited for ISIS? I don't even know what's happening now.
You know what I think it is? It's like David's learning how to be friends with women, but he's not entirely sure how to approach this conversation. Mm. He's trying to, like, figure out your level so that he can, like, forge a real friendship.
No, I'm attracted to very... I'm not... you're married, and I'm not attracted to you.
Oh, boy, here we go.
Well, the feeling is mutual.
Thank you. In fact, you disgust me.
Mega disgust me.
I mean, you're repulsive. No, but I do.
Literally, I'm projectile vomiting right now.
I find very intelligent women intimidating. And
yes, you've made that abundantly clear.
And I like to alpha dog them and make them feel stupid.
That's right, by obsessively going over your old weird jokes.
No, I think smart women.
Zing, ding, 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 paka, paka, pa.
No, I'm fascinated by smart women.
Here's three shows I really enjoyed lately that I think you might enjoy, too. Number one, Occupied. It's on Netflix. It's a Norwegian show that is taking place in the very near future. It's from an idea by Joe Nesbo, that Scandinavian crime author guy.
I know his sister.
Yeah, yeah,
yeah. I know his sister doesn't like men.
Stop it. Stop it. You know what? Don't even...
It was just sad is what that was. It was just sad.
It would
Stop
be
it. No.
It wasn't even charming.
Nope.
His name is Nesbo. He has a sister.
Please, no, you know what? Women like is being interrupted with, like, unworthy comments, like, over and over and over again.
You know what?
Do your own fucking podcast. Like, you can do your own separate podcast where you just say your own jokes out loud to your own self.
No, you have to book, like, young women you can interrupt and talk over.
Yeah.
You'll notice the restraint that I didn't say Joe Lesbo. I think I get
You don't get any credit for that.
But I didn't say it.
You implied it.
Yeah.
No, actually, you did say it, but in the context of, like, I would never make this joke.
It was apparent.
Yeah, this shitty playing it both ways thing is not cute on you. Yeah, it's not a good look.
It doesn't work because... It doesn't work for us because we recognize it.
All right. Occupado on Telemundo.
Occupied.
Occupado on Telemundo.
It's actually called Okupert. Okkupert.
Is that Norwegian for Occupado?
Yep. So it takes place in the very near future, and the conceit of the show is that Norway has decided to stop producing all oil and gas in order to commit completely to clean energy. So
there are no Jews in Norway, so it's a lot easier to stop producing gas.
Right, there's no pickled herring.
David's so mad right now.
No, I don't know. I don't know whether or not you're saying because if they're Jews, you have to get Zyklon B.
No, I thought it was because
they're gassy people.
Yeah, that's what I thought it was. Yeah,
Jews are gassy people.
Yeah, but then I was like, but there is a lot of pickled fish to be eaten in Norway.
That's true.
Either way, whether you're Goyish or Jewish,
that is true. That is true.
The stereotype about Jews being gassy, it was the Nuremberg defense.
I'll let that pity silence.
They were gassing themselves. So look at them.
So anyway,
I am in the
EU
glass booth, so I don't smell them.
So the EU and Norway, or I mean, the EU and Russia collude to basically force Norway to keep producing the oil and gas. And then slowly and incrementally, Russia, like, takes over Norway.
Mm-hmm.
And there's only, like, 10 episodes or 12 episodes in the first season, which is all that there is on Netflix right now. But it is so possible. This shit is a crazy series. It's so good.
We feed them the Chinese food, and we let them gas each other.
The Chinese food?
Yeah, it makes you gassy.
It's not I thought he was spicy. I thought he was doing a Norwegian accent.
I did at first, and then I was like, oh, no.
He's...
No, it was no, a you know what? German accent.
You know what? You guys are not turning this around on me. I'm not.
No,
gonna
no, no. You weren't in the moment.
Well, I was going to bring back this joke.
Yeah, you can't do that. On
and
this
really
show.
Annoy her.
You can't do this.
See, I was going to give you a lifeline.
At first, I thought you were being my dad.
No,
and I didn't understand what was happening.
Do you
so
love
that
your
was,
dad?
I do.
Good.
He's a good dad.
Good.
He was a good dad. He still is a good dad.
Good.
You His name is Eberhard.
You've got interesting
him.
Names in your life.
Mm-hmm.
You
and
still
your
see
husband's
him?
Name is?
Gardner Comfort. Gardner Bell Comfort is his full name.
That's
and
the,
his actual name.
That is such a great name.
It's a fantastic matinee idol name
and
of
you're,
Hollywood.
So, you know,
and he's a super nice dude.
You know what? Yeah. We started talking about World War II and the Japanese.
Mm-hmm.
And for my Japanese fans listening in Japan, we actually have a comfort woman here. Who is not Korean.
Don't ever call me that again. I mean, I did have sex with thousands of Japanese soldiers against my will, but I call it... I call it...
All right, that's it. You're coming back here every Saturday.
I call
you're
it...
Coming,
I call it the Rising Sun Ladies Auxiliary Service.
See? Now, you're coming back every Saturday.
You know why it's called the Rising Sun?
Liam, do you know of any jobs I can do that work on Saturdays?
I am calling.
You know why they're called the Rising Sun, by the way? Because those guys, much like David, never go down.
I am voting for the strike, because if there's a strike, that means Colleen...
will be unemployed.
And she'll be here every week.
Are you guild?
I am.
Okay. Okay.
As of 2010.
Congratulations.
Liam?
I will be free to sit in L.A. and crank out more spec scripts.
When are you coming back to New York?
I will probably be back for my birthday, which is August 1st. So that's probably I'm going to come back for a week and see some friends and, you know, like...
Why don't you come back here?
I got to work, you know, and there's...
We got to wrap it up.
There's no work for me in New York. That's... Well, you were so busy asking Colleen about TV shows.
All right.
Listen, I'm just saying, watch Occupied. It's totally worth it.
Okay. How do people reach you, Liam?
Go to heyitsliam.com. You can go on Spotify and listen to my albums, Working Class Fancy, Comedian. There's Tell Your Friends the Concert Film. I've done a lot of shit. And you know what else? 2016, GQ Spain called me one of the 100 funniest comedians of all time.
Nice.
GQ Spain.
GQ Spain.
España?
I get no love in America. But apparently in Europe, people dig my shit.
You're muy grande in Madrid.
I'm muy grande everywhere if I don't start working out.
And...
Hello, gentlemen!
Bling, 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 bling!
Coming up next, new Aria Grande!
Colleen?
Yes?
How do people reach you?
Tentatively at best.
How do people get in touch?
I have her phone number, so if anyone needs it, just email me.
First of all, I want to give a big shout out to all the basement masturbators. I didn't even reference them once this whole time.
Oh, the basement.
What's up, BMs? How you doing?
I don't get that.
Oh, that's what David's audience is comprised entirely of. Basement masturbators.
She said, I'm sorry to offend your listeners, all those basement masturbators, and that took off.
And then one man felt compelled to tell me that he lived in California and didn't have a basement, so I was like, okay, front yard masturbator.
Did he email you?
Yeah, he tweeted at me.
Yeah, a lot of...
Which you can also do, other basement masturbators.
Why don't we do
C. Werthmann.
And you can,
I'm going to say my Twitter handle.
You can tweet at me at Hey, It's Liam.
Okay, and how do...
I'm at C. Werthmann. That's C-W-E-R-T-H. M as in Mary, A, double N like in Nancy.
Can we get a...
That's some good branding.
We got to wrap it up. Can we get a wild line, and we'll start the podcast with this. Hello, I'm Colleen Werthmann. Hello, basement masturbators. This is Colleen.
This is another great David Feldman bit for his podcast.
This is Colleen. Hello, basement masturbators. This is Colleen.
I'm not going to do exactly what you tell
me.
Okay. What's up, basement masturbators? I'm Colleen Werthmann. You're listening to the David Feldman Show.
Yo. You listen to the hottest show on podcast. I'm Liam McEneaney. It's David Feldman Show right now.
Thank you.